We're at the kitchen table, and we have toothpicks. We put down one toothpick, and we notice it has two ends. So at each end, we put a toothpick. The toothpicks are all the same length, ideally. We started with one, and we added two. So now we've got three toothpicks. We notice now that there are four ends. So on each end, we put a toothpick. And these toothpicks actually touch. So those ends are no longer free. And we keep going. We do this forever. So the next generation, this is the fourth step, we had four free ends. We're going to add four more toothpicks. Those two toothpicks met at the middle, so those ends are no longer free. So now there are four ends. So we add four more toothpicks.
Mm-hmm. Oh, now we've got more.
Now we've got eight free ends. So we add eight toothpicks. And we keep going. And the question is, how many toothpicks do we have after N generations? Is there a formula? Well, this is a very lovely question. Let me show you. David Applegate, my former colleague at Bell Labs, made an animation of this and a number of related sequences. There we see one toothpick. Next, we added two toothpicks. Next, next. This is where we got to. Now we're going to add eight. And now we have 12 free ends. We're going to add 12 toothpicks. And so on. So let's watch it run. We see it growing. When we get to power of two, we notice something special happens. We have essentially a square that's full of toothpicks. There's no room in the middle to add any more toothpicks. There's a horizontal line of toothpicks at the top and the bottom, and there are four free ends. So by the rule, at step 17, we're going to add four toothpicks. The new toothpicks are always blue. So we've just added four. And now if we keep going, and you can see it growing from the corners. Now the interesting thing is that the growth from the corners after 16 generations is the same as the growth from the corners after 32. So let's let it run for a bit and admire it. So we're coming up to a new power of two, 128 generations. And again, it's growing, and it's growing from the corners.
And hypnotic, isn't it?
It's wonderful, yes. But you can do this on your computer at home. And you can see it's growing. And it's obviously a fractal-like structure. The growth from the corners has growth from the corners. The corners grow like earlier corners grew, and it grows and grows and grows. And the question is, how many toothpicks do we have after N generations? And I'll show you in a minute how we analyze this. But there are others that we were not able to analyze. So when you look at a seagull in the sky, it looks like that. So that's actually a toothpick. It happens to be bent, and it's got three ends. The rule is the same. Every free end, you add a toothpick, only this time they're gullwing toothpicks. Now we've got four wingtips, so we go there, and there, and there, and let's let it run and watch it, admire it growing. This is much more difficult. We have not analyzed this. Here, the growth from the corners is different at each power of two. It's still every power of two. It fills up a square as much as it can, but the growth from the corners is much less predictable.
Who even thought to make a gull toothpick? Like, where did that idea?
Omar Pohl. Yes, yes. Isn't that wonderful? Let me show you a couple of others before I show you a little bit of the mathematics of the analysis, which is actually just as pretty as the picture, but a different style. E toothpick, and see how that looks. Run. Yeah, yes, this is very Christmassy, snowflakey. And again, we don't understand this at all. We know how to generate it, but we don't have a formula for how many E toothpicks there are. We're going back to normal toothpicks now. So here are 10 generations, and you notice that after 8 generations, we have a square which is almost full as it can be. There's no room to put a toothpick. There are no free ends in this square. There are only four free ends. So after 8 generations, we add four again. It's just like at the beginning. One, two, three, four. We have eight free ends, so we add eight and we get there and so on. Now, if we look at a corner, let's focus on a corner. So after a power of two, what we're left with is a square with no holes in it. It's full up. And then at each of the four corners, there's half a toothpick sticking out. The first step is all we can do is add one toothpick there. And we'd, of course, add one at the other four corners. Now, the next generation, this has two free ends, so we add two toothpicks. Okay, now we have three free ends, so we add three more toothpicks. I'm now at generation, what is it, one, two, three. We're going to be able, we've still got three free ends. We add one, two, three. And now we have one, two, three, four free ends, so we add four toothpicks, and so on. After, I think this is seven steps, it looks like that. And if you stare at this, you see that it's really made up of three clumps, the corner sequence, after whatever it was, seven more steps. And this is true for any power of two. It's not just, you know, if you go out to 128 steps, we still see the same growth. 256, it still starts the same. It grows more and more because there's more room when we're out at 256. But the beginning is the same, always. When you look at it, you notice that after a power of two beyond where we were, we have three clumps. And so pay careful attention to how many there are. We find there's a formula. I was using L for the number in one of these clumps. And here we've got three clumps, two clumps which are seventh generational clumps, and one which is eighth generational. And we get a formula. And when we actually put all the pieces together, we find that we can explain the corner toothpicks. I won't really go into the details, but there's a very nice formula which explains after we've gone for a power of two plus I further steps, where I is one, two, three, four, five, and so on, there's a formula for the number in the corner which depends on k, the power of two, and I. And it's a very nice recurrence. Once we've noticed this recurrence, that the number, there's a way of writing down how many toothpicks there are in the corner in terms of something we already know, that's enough. We've now essentially cracked the whole problem. We know almost everything about it. We can work out, if you want to know the millionth term, we can do it easily. It solved the problem, and we wrote a paper about it. Omar Pohl, David Applegate, and myself. So that one we solved in the end. You might say on the scale of things, that was a pretty easy sequence to analyze. Now, there are a lot of others which are not so easy, like the seagull toothpick and the E toothpick. There is another couple of easy ones that I think are worth telling you about, particularly as they involve one of the famous scientists from Los Alamos, New Mexico, Stanislav Ulam. Let's imagine we have a large piece of squared paper, and each square is a cell, and we can say that cell is either alive or dead. It's on or off. It's zero or one. Maybe it's infected or it's not infected. There's a disease that's spreading. We want to know how fast the disease is spreading. Or maybe there's some chemical reaction which is going on. It starts off with one cell being active, and that activates other cells. We want to know how fast does this grow. It's understandable that this would be something that physicists and chemists and scientists and maybe nuclear scientists and mathematicians, people who are studying epidemics and so on. This is of universal interest, this question. How fast does something spread? A very simple version of this is what's called the Ulam-Warburton cellular automaton. And it works on cells. And it's a machine, that's why it's called an automaton. It proceeds on its own. And the idea is, we have to imagine we have a huge piece of graph paper with cells, square cells. And each one is surrounded by eight others. But actually, we'll only look at the four nearest neighbors of the cell. And we're going to start off where everything is clean. the pristine board, nothing is on. Suddenly, one of the cells gets turned on. I'll write a 1 instead of a 0. All the other cells are 0. The rule is, for this particular automaton, you look at a cell near this, it gets turned on if exactly one of your neighbors is on. This has one neighbor that's on, so it gets turned on. So that one turns on those four. Okay, now let's go on. At the next generation, this cell here has two neighbors that are on, so it does not get turned on. I'll put a 0. Likewise, that's a 0 and that's a 0. But this cell here does get turned on because it's got only one neighbor that's on. This is the Ulam Warburton cellular automaton. So let's have a look at it.
Can things get turned off or once you're on?
No, they can in versions of this. Of course, Conway's Game of Life, the cells turn on and turn off. These particular ones only turn on. You're either on or off. And once you're on, you stay on. And there it is. It starts off with one cell on. There it is. It's blue because it's a new cell. Okay, next. It turns on its four neighbors. And next, it turns on four neighbors again. It did not turn on that one because the rule is you turn on if exactly one of your neighbors is on. This one has two neighbors that are on, so it stays off. It is not infected. If we let it run, again, it's going to grow up. And again, you'll notice that every power of two, it's got a full square and it grows from the corners. And again, we can analyze it in the same way. And this one is even simpler. There's a simple formula for how many cells are on after n generations. Now we're doing the same thing, but our graph paper isn't squared graph paper anymore. It's a hexagonal paper. It's like the bathroom floors where you see hexagonal tiles. This is hexagonal tiles. Each cell has six neighbors now. But the rule is the same. You turn on if exactly one of your neighbors is on. So watch. If we let it run, it goes like this. Again, it has the same property that after a power of two, we have a full hexagon and it grows from the corners. But now, something really annoying or beautiful has happened. The growth from the corners. We're coming up to another power of two here. Watch it grow from the corners. If you stare at this, you can see in here, there's a pattern of black and white cells. At the next power of two, we see a different pattern. It does not repeat. It is very complicated. And over there, I have a very large piece of paper with my attempt to analyze it. Do you want to see it?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. This is my attempt, and it's not finished. I haven't given up, but I haven't solved it yet. It starts down here in the corner, and then it grows, and it grows, and it grows. And if we look here, you can see this is 16. So this is where we were after 8. Each power of 2, we get a closed hexagon. I'm just showing you one sector, 1/6 of the whole pizza, just a slice. So after 16, we have that. After 32, it's like that. And then if life were simple, there would be a predictable pattern. But there isn't. If you look at these squares, the colored squares, the red squares there are not like the red squares that we saw earlier. There are some similarities, so I haven't given up. But this is really tricky. I think this one is doable, but some of the others, and there are a lot, as you saw there, there are 100 or more animations that you can look at. And some of them are very beautiful. I particularly wanted to show you Friedkin's Replicator. A graduate student at the University of Cambridge asked me if I could solve it. And I did. It was on the margin of what could be solved and what couldn't, but it was. The rule is, it's similar to the Ulam Warburton. You turn on if the number of neighbors that's on is odd, not one as it was for Ulam Warburton. If it's two, you turn off. But an odd number, you turn on.
Well, I like that. It's nice and arbitrary.
Well, the pictures are beautiful. look at this. Here's the first 16 generations. And then when you look at 32 generations, you ask, can we break it up into pieces that look like things we've seen earlier? And the answer is yes, you can, but it's a little tricky. And the reason it's called Friedkin's Replicator is if you have some shape, any shape you like, say that, then after a certain number of generations, you see two copies of it. It replicates itself. That's why Friedkin, being a famous computer scientist at MIT, who studied many things like this.
Don't think it was worth all that. I've done lots of other mathematical things. And so I found the game of life was sort of overshadowing much more important things, and I did not like it.
We agree on that, right? 2 in 3 chance you've chosen a goat. So this scenario, of course, should be of more interest to us. It's the more likely scenario.